Welcome to Wildcat TV.
Hey Wildcats, welcome back to another episode of Wildcat TV on youtube.com/WildcatTV. This is a very special edition of our stay-at-home series because today I want to be able to thank all of the people who have made all of this craziness a little bit easier. Our first guest is Dr. Kathleen Ming. It was really nice being able to talk with her and seeing different things about her insights and what we should be doing as the stay-at-home orders become lifted. Let's see what all she had to say.
First, I want to be able to say thank you for everything you've been doing, for all of this craziness that's been going on. I know that my family really has appreciated all of your help recently, and I know a lot of other people do as well.
Well, it definitely has to be a passion to get through a global pandemic doing this, but I do love what I do, so yeah, happy to.
Thank you. I guess for one of my first questions, what has it been like throughout this time experiencing different things like in the hospital?
I would tell you that it is a time of a lot of transition, a time of fear. When this first started, not really anybody knew what to expect. And then it was, what do we need to do to protect ourselves? What do we need to do to protect our patients? What equipment do we need? There was a shortage of equipment that is better now. It's certainly not perfect, but we know a lot more now, eight weeks into the process than we did when it originally started. That fear has certainly been replaced a little bit more by the knowledge base that we've had. I would tell you that the medical community has certainly come together and collaborated at a level I've never seen before. We are certainly the penicillin generation of physicians, nurses, etc. And we definitely were trained at a time where you learned disease state, you learned how to treat it, and that's how we learned, where now we have a disease that is novel, it's new, we've not seen it before, our bodies haven't seen it before, so there's no treatment protocols, there's no testing. So all of that has been done in the last 6 to 8 weeks, and so it's been a global effort, not just in the United States, but the level of collaboration among scientists, physicians, nurses, et cetera, in the medical community has been something I've never experienced before, and all of that in a very good way. Across specialties, across whatever part of the medical field that you do, we really have all come together and collaborated at a level that I've not experienced in a good way. So that part and that piece, there's always a lot of barriers. Doctors are very well protected, and so we don't always get to collaborate with each other because we can't get a hold of each other. Well, I would say that the COVID-19 certainly has cut down all those barriers, and we are talking like never before, and that's a really good thing. So
that's awesome to hear that there's been so much progress within the medical community in being able to figure out all of this within just a short period of time that we've been going through this so far, since it's never been dealt with before. Within like different things that you've seen within our own like area of Blue Springs and like the Kansas City metro area, do you see that there's progress towards things declining and things hopefully being able to calm down?
I think that certainly we have what we call flattening the curve. I think we have not overwhelmed our medical system. I'm very hopeful that by everybody sheltering in place and doing their part, that our medical system doesn't get overwhelmed in the Kansas City area like it has in other areas of the country. I'm very encouraged. We always know that you'll hear a numerator, denominator, statistics. If anybody who's taken statistics know that you can manipulate statistics to look at what you want or make you look the way you want. But for us, there really has not been enough testing to really truly appreciate the number of cases that there are out there. We know that, again, the denominator is much bigger. In other words, we haven't had enough tests to know really truly how many people have had coronavirus or COVID-19. And so we are very hopeful as we phase into, so we often in the medical community talk about flipping the switch versus turning the knob. So we hope that we turn the knob, in other words, that we phase back into being with each other and being in groups, and that we don't just flip the switch and that we haven't, we don't open the floodgates, so to speak. Just because we're opening things back up doesn't mean coronavirus is gone, unfortunately. We don't have a way to do that yet. Like I said, all that progression in 6 weeks, we still don't, there's not going to be a cure, and it's going to be around for the time, for quite some time. The biggest thing we've done is not overwhelm our medical system, so that we're able to continue to take care of people, not only with COVID-19, but with all the other things that we take care of in the medical community. So yes, I'm very hopeful that we definitely are starting to develop some immunity, or we're starting to see people recover. And so I'm very hopeful that we can get back to somewhat of normal, although that's going to look like a new normal for a while, so we don't overwhelm our healthcare system.
Yeah, that's awesome. With going forward, I know that the Missouri stay-at-home order is being lifted on the 5th, I believe, and then Kansas City's is being lifted on the 15th. What are different things that you have as advice as we transfer back into a little bit of normalness that you have as like a little bit of expertise, saying like, even though these things are happening, these are still things that you should follow?
So I think just like we did when the first part of February, when we started talking about what is social distancing, nobody had ever heard of that before. That's a new term. You still have to do that. 6 feet, it's a magic number. It's not really magic, but when you are in gatherings and there are people that you don't live with, stay a little bit further apart from them. Also, if you, we know that wearing masks do help out in public. It really protects you or other people from you, and you from other people. It's certainly not something that's going to give you 100% protection from the virus by any means. However, it will remind you not to touch your face. We as humans love to touch our face, touch things, touch our face, and we don't even realize that we're doing it. So that's one thing that you can do to protect yourself and just remind yourself. The other thing is to wash your hands. I mean, that's really, it sounds very simple, but wash your hands. And try to, like I said, distance from people that are not living in your household. That doesn't mean you can't go out and do the things that are okay. They're going to start limiting the number of people that can be in places, and you can still be socializing with people in places, but just realize that you really have to kind of stay in your own home family group. So those are simple things that you can do. Outside has not ever been closed. You can still get outside. It's beautiful spring. Go, please, you know, get outside and enjoy that. Just maybe do it with your home group, not necessarily with all your friends. Doesn't mean you can't see your friends. Please go see your friends, interact with them, but do it in a safe manner. Just like I would recommend you to do it now. Go, you know, stay 6 feet apart. Maybe do it outside instead of in somebody's home. Those are things that are still all real and realities to us. So I said it's like turning the knob, not flipping the switch. So if you need to go get your hair cut, go get your hair cut.
Well, thank you so much for like spending this time to meet with me again. I really appreciate all of your help and being able to help me in this process. But I really appreciate you doing this for me.
Yeah, absolutely. No problem.
Thank you, Dr. Ming. And as we all have seen, online schooling is a very real thing for all of us right now. Speaking of online schooling, let's see how our teachers are reacting to all of this and how they've been able to adapt their classrooms from in the classroom to online.
Where do I start? It was definitely a rough transition, moving from seeing students and abruptly moving to not seeing students. I had a tough time at first kind of deciding how I was going to go about redoing 5 different preps and how that would affect students, how it would affect my day, how it would affect my kids at home. So getting into the schedule was really rough. I think it took us 3 weeks to finally feel somewhat normal. But I think my college classes probably were the easiest of transitions, mostly because I had them for a full year and we had really good relationships going into it. And I knew their work ethic and their mostly their situations of moving forward. So the nice thing is the majority of those students are still very engaged and doing things with me and online and everything through Teams. I had definitely had to learn a lot on how to use Teams. So that was different, and understanding everybody's Wi-Fi issues, video issues, what they knew, what they didn't know, how to use Teams. I think that, again, the hardest part has been getting my other students engaged in my semester classes, because we didn't have as much time together and we had a different relationship where it was just a short class. Entrepreneurship was really tough because I had been telling them, like, hey guys, after spring break, like, we get to get really interactive, really hands-on. You're gonna learn so much from, you know, all the things that we're gonna do, and the experience is gonna be awesome. And then they didn't get that, and so a lot of them were very bummed and upset, and I definitely can't do the same things virtually, which is really upsetting. There's definitely a lot to talk about in the entrepreneurship world right now, but it's also tough when I can't really engage with them as well and get them all on board to be on a video call or anything. So I think that's been the toughest, is not being interactive with those students who probably need it most. So I don't know. Those are my thoughts. I don't know. What other things are you thinking about? I have a girl that needs a ponytail.
Okay.
Give me a second. Okay.
How has your plan changed for, like, all of your classes, being that you do have multiple of them? What has that looked like, moving it to home?
It's been different. I tried to get into a consistency of some sort with each class, and that looks different for each class. So for example, college entrepreneurship, they had already had their book studies picked out. That was easy to transition into doing virtual. So I think for the first few weeks, we did some entrepreneur guest speakers on Zoom at the time. And that was really fun because it was just like we had never left class. Of course, we couldn't be in person, but we got to ask the same questions, learn the same things, and do it a little differently, which was totally fine. And then they've been doing book presentations each day where they have to get on so many of them and watch and learn from the students that read the book. So that's been really cool. So they're doing great. Again, we've had that kind of relationship going into this, so that's really what made that work. And so that has been pretty nice. And again, my other classes, I kind of put them on a virtual business simulation of lessons, and you know, I would say about a third of them are fine doing it. Definitely wouldn't be what we'd be learning normally in class, but I just thought that doing something consistent would be the easiest right now with them having a bunch of other classes at the same time. So I've had to find some alternate assignments for that as well, which again, it's just constantly creating, constantly trying to find better things for students to do if that's not accessible for them. So it's just been really hard to, like, really initiate change for everybody that needs it.
Well, we have to use a whole bunch of different platforms we haven't used as much. Like, I've used EdSite and the online book, but I don't use it every day. Now it's like an everyday scenario. Or email me or get a hold of me 1:30 in the morning at times. So I'm literally a 24/7 tech person, and so I've had to adjust myself and tell them, okay, 10 o'clock, cut it off. But I'm there all the time, and I have it on my phone, so I'm carrying it around with me everywhere, so I can't take a break. Yeah.
How have the students been reacting to the work so far? Has it been good for them, or has it been a little bit of like a back and forth kind of thing?
Well, it started out good, and everybody was pretty much getting their work in, except for the ones that were having technology difficulties, so they had to pick up packets, and so their work would come in slower. So we're not giving late grades as long as we get their work. We're still doing grades where some districts might not be doing grades. We still are doing, we have a higher standard in the Blue Springs School District, and we expect kids to get their work done and still learn. My problem is I'm a better in-person teacher. You can't get the personality, you can't get the know if the kids are understanding if you can't see them. So I'm talking a lot more with parents than I've done before. Trying to FaceTime, we were doing Zoom, can't do Zoom now, at the middle school level at least. And I don't know, it's really hard. I'm just trying to give my kids grace and hoping they give me grace back, because it's new to all of us and we're trying our hardest to do what we can.
Well, also, happy Teacher Appreciation Week.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that a lot. And it's so good to see you. I love seeing my prior students. I miss you all. And to everybody in the Wildcat life, Mrs. Barr, miss you. You're a senior. Keep in touch.
I definitely will. When I'm home on breaks, I will try and come and visit as much as I can, because I won't be too far away because I'll be at the zoo.
Well, keep in mind, I'm in seventh grade now instead of eighth grade. And any of the Wildcats out there that are going to A+ for Brittany Hill, I am their contact person as well.
Awesome. Well, thank you for your time.
No problem.
All right. Bye. Bye.
Yeah, it's changed a lot. So first I had to learn how to use Teams. That was new to us. Some people have used it. I did not use it with my class at the time. So as a grade level and at Lucy Franklin, we worked together to help each other through that. And then I invited my students, and we started just by having a read aloud. So I would meet with them for 30, 45 minutes each day of the week, and so we could finish our read aloud. We were in the middle of a read aloud when all this started. And from there, we started adding a classroom meeting, and it kept going better and better, to where I started allowing kids to run the meetings, just weather, today in history, that kind of thing. And finally, each week I'm learning new things, and so I've now been able to add a few lessons. So our students have packets that they're working on, and the second packet is great because it's broken down by weeks. And so the students are working on those, and as teachers, we're checking in with our kids weekly, or with the parents weekly, to see how that's going, to see what they need help with. But in addition to that, other teachers have created videos or lessons, and I can incorporate those on Teams during our meetings. I've started making PowerPoints of some of our writing lessons so that I can model a writing lesson to my class. And then I share it with them during our meeting, but it's also then on Teams for parents to check, and so that they can see kind of the expectations or what we would hope that they will do. So that's been the biggest change, is that I'm not there to physically teach them, and it would kind of be impossible to do every lesson that we teach in elementary live. So just trying to add things that are more difficult for parents to figure out on their own. That's the main way that it's changed. I hate not seeing their faces every day as they come down the hallway, and just hearing about their day and about how things are, and getting to tell them goodbye at the end of the day. But Teams has been a good way for us to connect about 4 days a week. And It allows them some chat time and just that keeping that connection there.
That's awesome that like we've been able to get things to the point where students are still able to learn even though we're not in the classroom. And I'm really glad that things seem to be going well, even though we all do miss school very, very much. But I'm glad that there's been a way that we can help all sorts of students be able to still learn throughout this time.
Yes, I've 27 years teaching and never had anything like this. I mean, it's new for all of us, but thank goodness for technology. I don't know what would have happened if we didn't have a way to keep in touch that way.
Yeah, I definitely agree. To keep things nice and light, here's a highlight of different things that Wildcats have been able to do within this time to spread joy and happiness. Our wonderful teachers have been helping out with the food drop-off sites. Alexis Hayes decided to make her neighborhood pretty with a little bit of chalk art. Sydney Clark decided to give a little bit of a shout out to her teachers to say thank you during Teacher Appreciation Week. And Senate even did a Digital Spirit Week a couple weeks ago. As we've seen that this is a huge transition time for all of us, students, teachers, administration, and everybody in our community, we want to be able to also realize that there are good things to come. Seniors, don't forget to save the dates of July 18th and 19th and 25th and 26th for a possible graduation reschedule. We will still hopefully be able to graduate and be able to walk the stage like normal, even if it may be rescheduled for a later time. Keep hope, everything will be okay. And remember, it's a great day to be a Wildcat.